I presented last time a representation of the canonical commutation relations for the case of infinite number of degrees. And this was the analog of our Schrödinger representation written in terms of creation and annihilation operator. So this is a very canonical representation. And now, of course, the question arises, is this the only one? And as I already told you, that's not the case. So the situation for an infinite number of degrees of freedom is very different from the finite situation. And I already mentioned that this is related with the question of an infinite tensor product. So we will, in this chapter, first talk about infinite tensor products of Hilbert spaces. That's where we want to realize our relations of Hilbert spaces, and then we will see that different choices of tensor products really leads to inequivalent representations of the CCR. So that's, I mean, that's what we really want to see, that in this situation there are many more representations which are not equivalent to each other. Inequivalence of representations of the canonical commutation relations, but for an infinite number of degrees of freedom. In the case of a finite number of degrees, we of course know by this Stone von Neumann uniqueness theorem that all irreducible ones are equivalent. Good, okay, so what we are interested are the canonical commutation relations of infinite degree of freedom. So I mean, that's how I want to denote this, or maybe more general, let me put CCR of n. So this should be the canonical commutation relations for n degrees of freedom. And so what we understand quite well is the situation where n is finite. Yeah, but now we are interested in the situation if n is infinity. So we are interested in the representations of the canonical commutation relations in the case where n is infinity. Yeah, okay, and the idea is that if I have a representation of CC1, so for 1 degree of freedom, I can take tensor products for getting the case of several degrees of freedom. So maybe let me do this for n equal to 2, where this is clear and there is no problem. But then the question is, can we also do this for an infinite product? Okay, so let us consider representations for the case of 1 degree of freedom. So let's say our Schrödinger representation, but taking this twice on maybe the same or on different Hilbert spaces. So let's say we consider P1 and Q1 on H1. Okay, so I'm writing in terms of P and Q. Of course, we know to make it rigorous and not having to deal with the domains of our unbounded operators, we should do it for the Weyl relations and the Weyl operators. But I mean, on a formal level, maybe it's better to write it down in terms of P and Q. So assume I have my operators P and Q realized on the Hilbert space H1, and I have P2 and Q2 realized on H2, and each of them is a representation of 1 degree of freedom. So the commutator of P and Q is I times or minus I times the identity. So each of them is a representation of the commutation relations for 1 degree of freedom. And then, of course, I can just take tensor products, because if I go to 2 degrees, I mean, what happens? I mean, the P and Q, they should satisfy the same relations among themselves, and the only thing which comes in addition is I have to say what is the relation between the guys numbered by 1 and the guys numbered by 2, but all of them commute. And this means, of course, I should realize things in a way that my P1 and Q1 and the P2 and the Q2, they commute among each other. And of course, the tensor product is the arena where I should do this. So this means I look on the Hilbert space, H1, tensor H2, and of course I have canonical ways of realizing those guys on this tensor product and those guys on the tensor product. So namely the P1 and the Q1, I let them act only on the first component in the tensor product. So this means I'm taking P1 tensor 1 and Q1 tensor 1. And for the P2 and Q2, I'm doing it the other way around. I let them act on the second factor in the tensor product. This means I take one tensor P2 and one tensor Q2. And those are now operators which all act on H1 tensor H2. So I mean, P1 tensor 1 acting on a vector from here acts only on the first component and doesn't do anything for the second one. There it is, the identity. Yeah, and then of course it's very easy, and actually I even asked you in one of the assignments just to check this, that now of course those guys among themselves satisfy the same relations as before, but in addition the relations between those and those is that they commute. So this means those operators now satisfy the canonical commutation relations for 2 degrees of freedom. So this here gives now a representation of CCR of 2. Yeah, okay, and of course, I mean, if our representation for n degrees of freedom, which I only mentioned briefly, is of course of this form. So the Schrödinger representation of the CCR for n degrees of freedom, which lives on L2 of R to the n, this is the n-fold tensor product of the canonical of our Schrödinger representations of L2 of R. So this is the n-fold tensor product of the representations of CCR of 1, which lives on L2 of R. That was our representations, which we really considered very carefully and detailed. And maybe the one for n degrees, I just mentioned this shortly, but of course it's clear how it acts. So this was in 8.6, where I wrote down a little bit how this acts. Of course, I mean, the Q's are just the multiplication operators for each of the variables, and the P's are just the differentiation operators for each of the variables. And if you think a little bit about it, this representation you can identify with the tensor product of the one-dimensional representations. Yeah, but now of course, if we can do this for a finite number of degrees, so I mean, why not doing it for an infinite number? So taking just an infinite tensor product of the one-dimensional representations to get our representation of CCR for an infinite number. The idea which this suggests, so we should represent the canonical commutation relations for an infinite number of degrees of freedom as an infinite tensor product. And of course, we should think what this means and whether this makes sense of representations of the one-dimensional case. Let's say we represent this on H, and then we should take infinite tensor product of H's so that we have infinitely many copies of our representation which can act on each of the components. And they should commute among each other, and of course each of them should still satisfy the original algebraic relations. Good. Okay, and in principle this works, but we have of course to be more careful about infinite tensor product. I already mentioned this kind of problem when we talked about the tensor product and the direct sum. I mean, a direct sum in the full Fock space construction is really a direct sum where we take essentially infinitely many, or we don't take infinitely many elements, but we essentially we have embeddings of the components which we have there, and we have an embedding because we have a zero in a Hilbert space. And for the tensor product, if we want to make, if we take infinitely many, we should also identify the finite terms among each other, and for this we should also have embeddings of the Hilbert spaces, of the tensor products into themselves. But in a Hilbert space, there is no canonical vector 1, which would be the canonical choice for making this embedding. So we don't have a canonical choice, but we have many choices which also work for this. But these many choices are really, they are different, and the question is, are they related or not? And that's what we really have to understand. Okay, so the problem is that this notion of an infinite tensor product is a priori problematic. So it's maybe it's not really straightforward to define it, a notion of infinite tensor product of Hilbert spaces is problematic. And it will turn out that we can define it, but there are actually many inequivalent ones. So not one canonical choice, but actually many of them. And we will see they are inequivalent in a sense, which in the end leads to inequivalent representations of our CCR. Yeah, okay, so what is the problem? So I mean, we want to define infinite tensor product of Hilbert spaces. So let's say we have Hilbert spaces. Of course, in the end, I mean, maybe all of them are the same, but for clarity or for generality, let's just take arbitrary ones. So we have a sequence of Hilbert spaces H1, H2, H3, and so on, infinite sequence, and we want to take their tensor product. So we want to define actually a tensor product over Hilbert spaces Hi, but I runs now over all the natural numbers. So this will be an infinite tensor product. And of course, what we want is, so this should be a Hilbert space, which of course should be generated by guys which are infinite sequences of elements, which we can denote by this tensor sign. And for those, we should say, what should the inner product on those be? The generating elements in my infinite tensor product should be guys of the form x1, tensor x2, tensor x3, but now, it's an infinite sequence. Formally we could just say this is a sequence of elements, where the first guy comes from H1, the second one comes from H2, next one from H3, and so on. And we take all those guys, and of course we take linear combinations, and we have to complete it in some norm, and the norm should come from inner product, which we have to define. And of course the crucial thing is, how should we define the inner product between one such elementary infinite tensor and another one, let's say y1 tensor y2 tensor and so on. Okay, so that's the basic ingredient which we have to say what this is. And of course for a tensor product, the inner product of a tensor product of Hilbert spaces should just be the product of the inner product for each component. So it's clear that we should define this as the product of the inner products between the first component times the second component and so on. So this should be the product over xi, yi, where I is running over n. Okay, and of course that's what we are doing in the case of finite tensor product. But now, of course, if I have here an infinite one, then I have the question whether this converges or not. So I have here an infinite product, and of course this is not so clear whether it converges. So it might converge in many cases to zero, but it might also explode. So the question is whether this definition makes sense. So this is our wannabe definition, and of course we have to make sense. First of all, this product must converge. So we can only consider guys here for which it is clear that this converges. So the question is really about the convergence of this. Yeah. Okay, and I mean now, so this was worked out by von Neumann. So von Neumann made a very, very detailed and very, very nice and beautiful analysis of this situation. And he also talked an analysis of infinite products of real or complex numbers. So it's a really very big, detailed, but very nice paper from, I think, 39 or so, where he really defined all those things. And I mean, he actually looked on different possibilities. I think in principle you could say, I mean, I take my infinite tensor product as the space where somehow I can guarantee that this converges and make this as general as possible. And that's what he called the complete tensor product. That's a very big space where you can make sense out of this here. Okay, but then he also restricted to more special situations where actually you have better reasons that this converges because you make more assumptions what you consider. And this essentially gives you what he called an incomplete tensor product, and there are many different choices of this. Of course, incomplete tensor product is a bad, somehow not a good word in this context, because a Hilbert space is always complete. So it means more that you take here the big one, and then you take many sub-situations of this. And what we are going to do is just look on the incomplete ones. Maybe the complete tensor product is just a too big construction, which never really shows up in a meaningful sense, and one just looks on the incomplete specific situations. Okay, so this, let me just write it down. So there's something which is called complete tensor product, which just makes the definition that whenever you can make sense anyhow out of this, then that's all the situation that's what you consider in your tensor product. But then maybe the more important notion is that you take an incomplete tensor product where you have more specific assumptions what you allow here. And this goes more with this idea that you should have embeddings of the finite situations into each other. Okay, and in particular, in this infinite product, I mean, what you really want is that you consider situations where in this infinite product you have almost factors one. I mean, so this product here converges. I mean, a product converges, should converge to something. Of course, I mean, your terms shouldn't be too far away from one, at least if your index is getting large. And maybe the best situation is if you can guarantee that here you have, okay, you have first some factors which you don't care about, and then from some point on you get only terms which are equal to one. And this can be guaranteed. I mean, let's say you have one vector here and you have one vector here, but you want that the pairing between them, at least starting from one point on, is equal to one, and this can be guaranteed if you only look on sequences which from some point on just have one unit vector there, let's say one vector ei. So that you have an ei here and here have an ei here, and the inner product between them is one, which means all the tail terms here, starting from somewhere on, is just one, and then it's clear that at least this infinite product makes sense. So this means you just start from vectors where from one point on you have the same unit vector here, and then of course you have to take linear combinations and you have to complete it. But at least this is something which you can control quite easily. So the idea is, so the convergence here in this, I mean, that's our definition as we would like to make it, but we have to ensure somehow that the infinite product on the right-hand side converges, and so the convergence in this formula so is clear or is guaranteed if we have that the inner products, which are showing up here for the various terms corresponding to the factors here, xi, yi, is always equal to one for large i. And of course, it, I mean, for which I, how large it has to be, can of course depend on the considered tensor, which I have, infinite tensor, which I have here. Okay, and this we can guarantee if we require that the elements in my infinite tensor here, the xi and the yi, are actually the same, namely equal to one fixed vector ei from my Hilbert space hi, if I make the I large enough. For large I, for fixed ei in my Hilbert space hi, and of course I mean that this is equal to 1 means, of course, this should be unit vector. So it should be a vector of norm 1. So this norm of ei should be equal to 1. Yeah, okay, and that's the definition, which I now will going to make more formal. And that's what is called an incomplete tensor product, and which was introduced by von Neumann.